you and I have an incredibly hardworking friend who is completely underappreciated and is in serious trouble. And there's something out in space that can significantly help our friend. You're gonna love it. You're gonna love it. But first, let's take a moment to appreciate the hard work that our friend does for us. I'd like to tell the story of our friend's hard work through, of all things, a fruit salad. Some strawberries, blueberries, we'll throw in some sliced apple. It's easy to taste each delicious bite. You see, our friend is the relentless worker that visited each plant for this fruit salad, moving pollen between flowers to produce these specific fruits. Pollinators. Honeybees, bumblebees, monarchs, birds, hoverflies, and other beneficial insects provide an incredible service, moving a sufficient amount of pollen between flowers to produce the beautiful fruits and vegetables for our markets. Because without their hard work, fruit doesn't grow, or it ends up smaller and misshapen. Evidence of poor pollination is easy to find. In the United States each year, bees provide more than $15 billion of pollination services to our agricultural sector. And globally, their contribution is more than $200 billion. Now, for this one common fruit salad made with these ingredients, bees had to make more than 1,000 individual visits to flowers. That's 2 to 3 visits per blueberry, 2 to 4 visits per apple, 5 to 6 visits per raspberry, and incredibly, 20 or more visits for each and every market-ready strawberry. Now, there's around 200 or so blueberries in a given pint. So when you just eat the whole thing the way my 5-year-old did after raiding the grocery bag, that's 400 to 600 pollinator visits right there. And it's not just our fruit salad. 1/3 of every bite of our diets, 75% of crops globally, rely on bees and wildlife to move pollen between flowers. Even milk. You see, alfalfa and clover require pollination, and they're the primary food stock for dairy cattle. We and the livestock we raise, I'm talking to you carnivores, rely on pollinators for our food. Okay, it's about to get real. To maximize the yield of coffee, you need pollinators. 20 to 40 visits for each and every coffee flower, which gives you one of these coffee cherries, which gives you 2 coffee beans. The simple morning ritual of a single cup of coffee is a harvest representing between 1,000 and 2,000 individual visits from bees to flowers. Billions of fruits, trillions and trillions of visits to flowers. Now, this topic is timely because, unfortunately, populations of pollinators are in crisis. The story is not new, it's just new to us. You see, in southwest China, farmers lash chicken feathers to bamboo rods and then use those tools to pollinate crops by hand. The bees there have been wiped out by insecticides. They visit each flower of these pear trees. Back in the United States, a single acre of blueberries has around 10 million little blueberry flowers, all blooming at about the same time, and if you don't get them pollinated within a few days, no fruit. Nationally, we cultivate 82,000 acres of blueberries. So that's 820 billion blueberry flowers. Yeah, it sounds like an extraordinary amount of work, but only until you compare it to the annual almond harvest and almond bloom, which has 3 times as many flowers. We're not pollinating our crops by hand. We're not there yet. But our fields are becoming quieter, our gardens are becoming more still. Evidence of the eerie absence of natural wildlife is coming with greater and greater regularity. For example, the honeybee. Since the 1950s, we've lost nearly 50% of our honeybee population. The Federal Pollinator Protection Plan established a goal of to maintain that annual loss at 15%. Unfortunately, last year's annual loss was 33%, representing nearly 900,000 dead beehives. And then the rusty patch bumblebee, once common in 28 states from the Dakotas to Maine to Virginia, is now 90% population depleted. And according to the Xerxes Society, an organization exclusively committed to the conservation of insects and other invertebrates, the rusty patch is one of a dozen species of native US and Canadian bumblebees at risk of extinction. And while they're not doing much pollinating, we see similar trends in other important and beloved species, like birds. Peer-reviewed science from Audubon shows that half of the bird species on the continent are at risk. You see, in order to manage the worst effects of a changing climate, native birds need native plants and the insects that have co-evolved with them. No insects, no birds. And finally, the monarch. Since 1990, we've lost nearly 1 billion monarchs. And if the current trends continue, a viable population of the eastern monarch could be wiped out by a single storm within our lifetimes. Taken as a whole, this is what one leading scientist refers to as an all-hands-on-deck moment. Now, pollinator protection is featured for the first time this year on a US postage stamp, and nationally, this issue is getting a lot of attention, and it's easy to understand why. Pollinators are important to us and other wildlife. Pollinators are in decline, and compared with some of the wicked problems we face as a society, we can do something about it. You see, habitat loss is a leading cause in the decline of these species. But providing healthy sources of pollen and nectar free of insecticides has not been simple. Turf grass lawns now cover an area 4 times larger than the state of New Jersey, 40 million acres. Suburbs are expanding, corporate campuses, mini marts, urban and suburban homeowners mostly aren't giving up their lawns. And farmers face pressure to increase crop yields. New practices have largely eliminated the pollinator-friendly plants from the row crop fields that dominate production acreage. So what can we do about it? That's kind of the way things are. But you know, we can plant backyard gardens. In fact, the National 2015 Pollinator Protection Plan encouraged each of us to plant a backyard garden of any size. And that's important. Yes, we should do this. And also, we need to think creatively to bring in new capital, new partners, to push ourselves and see new opportunities. And you know, in that mindset, I want to tell you a story about back in 1993, entrepreneur Paul Hawken, he challenged each of us, engineers, designers, everyone, to come up with a system, to create a system that profitably nourishes and enriches life on Earth. And so I want to share an unusual and unexpected way that we can significantly help our pollinator friends. And like I said, it starts way off in space, but then it comes right back down to farmland and what these species need to survive. In the earliest days of the space race, batteries were incredibly heavy and also only ran for a few days. And the US was looking for ways to power satellites for years at a time. So sure enough, by the 1960s, all satellites were equipped with solar panels. Now, since then, a combination of public and private investments in research and development, paired with state-level policies, have driven the cost of solar down by more than 99%. Solar is so cheap now, in many areas, it's cheaper to build a new giant-scale solar array than to continue to pay the millions of dollars for coal and maintenance costs on those old smokestack power plants. And just like the ones in space, these are photovoltaic or PV solar panels. They don't get hot because they're just converting sunlight directly into electricity, and they're the common kind you see on rooftops and built into some camping equipment. And interest in solar is growing incredibly fast. Here's the rate of growth for solar from 1992 to 2012. And for comparison, that's roughly 8 times faster than the rate of growth for mobile phones and the internet during the same period. Now, working in the public interest, economically and environmentally minded nonprofit groups, like the one I work for, have been encouraging this energy transition. Clean air, clean water, economic development. More and more businesses and municipalities, homeowners and churches, data centers and school districts have been saving hundreds to thousands to millions of dollars by getting more of their electricity from the sun. So solar is safe and it helps people save a lot of money. But some communities have expressed real concern about how much land is used for some of these solar sites. And I, too, am concerned about the productive use of agricultural land. Farmland. Isn't that where our food comes from? And so that's why in 2016, a coalition of agricultural, conservation, and energy groups came together, leaders here in Minnesota, to propose a new vision for solar development in the North. It looks like this. Okay, seriously, it looks like this. We call it pollinator-friendly solar. And I'm sorry, it's not new, and it's not radical. We imported it from Europe, where it's been common for years and years. The key questions remain, though. Will it cost too much to do this in most places? And then, if we do, will it make any difference? Now, this could be a little bit of a complicated calculation, so let's see if I can get some help there. I have a supercomputer in my pocket. Hey, supercomputer, could you calculate the cost difference for using a pollinator-friendly seed mix on most solar arrays versus the current industry practice of using turf grass or gravel?
Hello, Rob. You don't need a supercomputer for this. The costs of plant seed are equal or less than using gravel.
Great. Thanks, supercomputer. I appreciate your help on that.
It is important that we create more habitat for our pollinators.
Supercomputer, I had no idea you were so passionate about this issue.
Yeah, let's just say that it's kind of a family thing.
Family thing. Got it. Okay. Practically, this is actually really straightforward. Every solar array is going to have a vegetation management plan. The engineers simply work with an ecologist to design a pollinator-friendly seed mix of low-growing flowers and native vegetation around and under the panels. And then in the perimeter, taller species like milkweed and flowering shrubs. And it's not just good for pollinators. Compared to turf grass or gravel, those deep-rooted native plants capture the stormwater coming off the panels, channeling it right down into the aquifer, breaking up compacted soils, adding organic matter, and improving the quality of agricultural soils over the life of the project. Once a low-growing meadow is established, usually a period of 1 to 3 years, there's less mowing and significantly less incidence of mowers kicking up rocks or colliding directly with solar panels. And standards encouraging pollinator-friendly solar practices have been supported by overwhelming and bipartisan majorities in Minnesota and Maryland and are being developed in a growing number of states. Okay, but will it make any difference? You know, beekeepers that manage honey-producing hives on pollinator-friendly solar arrays describe them as a perfect environment, abundant and diverse nectar and pollen sources throughout the growing season, free of direct application of insecticides. And several of the world's foremost entomologists and their PhD students, are enthusiastic about this approach. But now compared to that backyard garden, which we should still plant, solar sites can provide habitat at scale. In fact, in 2016 alone, solar developers and utilities and rural electric cooperatives in Minnesota and Wisconsin developed around 2,500 acres of pollinator-friendly solar sites. Now, this is a ridiculously tiny fraction of the more than 40 million acres of farmland in these states. But for pollinators, it's habitat equivalent to 1.5 million homes having a 6-foot by 12-foot pollinator garden. And the land lease contracts that ensure maintenance of the vegetation are for 25 years. So for the more than 900 million acres of farmland that America has, and the tiny percentage of that which farmers will choose to use for solar, let's maximize that productivity. We need to create spaces for bees and pollinators to thrive. And solar sites can provide tens of thousands of new acres of habitat each year. So make a plan for your own pollinator garden. Audubon has an online tool that makes it as easy as entering your zip code. And also, importantly, make a plan to support and share and advance this idea of pollinator-friendly solar. With your help, this can maximize the productivity of farmland and create habitat to benefit pollinators and other wildlife for a generation. Now, I happen to be a father, and we all have young people in our lives that we care about. And when their children are the right age, we'll be able to share a story about a moment when we decided to support clean air and clean water and clean energy. We'll be able to share a story about a moment when we all decided to help these important and beloved species. We'll be able to make that fruit salad and appreciate each bite with a new perspective. And give thanks that we still have all of our hardworking pollinator friends. Thank you.